I hope PPT is visible now.
Yes,
Yes,
sir.
sir.
Oh, okay. So now it is part of module 5, and I plan to finish it today. We'll see. And there are two topics we are covering today. One is processing of plastic, and one more is processing of ceramics. In syllabus, they are not mentioned which method you have to study in module 5. There are many methods of production of plastics. There are many methods of production of ceramic material. For examination point of view, we'll study around 4 to 5 important processing method that is commonly used for development of plastic as well as development of ceramics. I hope everything is fine. PPT is visible?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Then if you come to, this is a plastic manufacturing. Whether you manufacture plastic, whether you manufacture rubber, whether you manufacture any material, there are some standard manufacturing method. Even casting also can be used for manufacturing of plastic. It can be used for manufacturing of ceramics. Even polymer matrix composite or ceramic matrix composite or metal matrix composite, those are the basic manufacturing process. Then forming is one more operation. Can you give some example for forming operation? Practical example. Any example for the forming? So forming, in most of the automotive bodies, aircraft outer bodies are produced by forming process. The forming is a general term. So there you are not going for casting, you are not going for removing the excess material. There is a one more process that is referred as machining process. The drilling is the machining process, shaping is again a machining process, and like that there are many machining process. You studied machine tools. In next semester you are going to study in details about the machine tool. But how it is differ from the forming is, in the case of forming, you are deforming the material plastically. So that is referred as a forming. Even what you do in your foundry and forging lab, forging operation, so that's also comes under forming process. So in the case of forming process, you are heating the material to some red hot condition or below the critical temperature. You have to remember one, there is a one temperature, that's a critical temperature. It may be referred as upper critical temperature or it may be referred as a lower critical temperature for timing. You remember, there is one temperature, critical temperature. If you heat the material above that particular temperature, then only it's your grain structure or crystal structure or the faces will change. Otherwise, it will just heat it to a certain temperature. There is no change in property. Inside microstructure, there is no change in microstructure. That particular temperature is referred as a critical temperature. You are going to study in heat treatment chapter. So most of the time you are referring it as a heating the material above upper critical temperature or heating the material above lower critical temperature. But it may be cold forming or it may be hot forming process. So what you are doing in your forging lab, that is a hot forming process. So that means you are heating the material above the crystalline temperature, then you are beating or you are hammering it to get the required size and shape. That is referred as a forming process. The same forming process can be used for production of ceramic material. Same forming process can be used for ceramic of the plastic material. The same forming process can be used for the development of your sheet metal work, even the regular computer or desktop for this what you call a CPU box. So all those, even almirahs, the chairs, benches, all those things are bent. See, we have the inside seat or plate that will be bent to required size and shape. Inside it is cut to the required size and shape. Then it is bent. The bending is the permanent bending process. Permanent bending process is nothing but a permanent set or plastic deformation process, if you talk in terms of mechanics of material or your material science. Then there is a one more process that is referred to as powder processing or powder metallurgy processing. So when, if it is like a aluminium, copper, steel, etc., we can heat, we can melt it easily around heating around aluminium. It is around aluminium. It is around 700 degrees Celsius, and copper and steel, it is around 800. To steel is around more than 1200 degrees Celsius. We heat, we can melt it. But there are some cases like a ceramic material that cannot be melt at low temperature. We require to heat the material to about 2000 degrees Celsius, 2500 degrees Celsius. In such cases, the designing of the furnace, the power requirement, and what is the crucible you are using, all those things, there are a lot of technical challenges. If you are heating the material about 2500 degrees Celsius, to get molten metal, to hold the molten metal, we have some required some material, so that material should not melt at 2700 degrees Celsius. Suppose you are holding the ceramic melt by your steel mold, or normally it is referred to as die, at 2700 degrees Celsius, the steel die will not hold the ceramic melt, because the steel die will melt at even 1700 1200 degrees Celsius. There are a lot of challenges also. Let's say even in the case of there are some cases we require some platinum die. So especially in the defense of application, especially atomic research application, so where the cost of the die, the platinum die itself, is around 20 to 25 crores. So that type of investment is required, especially for high temperature processing, especially nuclear power plant. There are high temperature processing components are there in such cases. So we require the platinum die. We know what is the cost of the platinum. It is almost equivalent to gold. Then if you have a platinum die of around 100 kg, just imagine what will be the cost of the die itself. So that's why, so in such cases, instead of going for the melting, so you are using powder of the metal A or ceramic material B, and you are mixing together, or it is referred as a blending. So then after blending, so then you have to go for compacting. After compacting, then you have to go for sintering process. Those are the different steps involved in the powder processing. Then we have standard plastic processing and other things you are familiar. The cutting, joining, and one more is surface heat treatment. Anyhow, we are going to discuss in details about surface treatment. Can you give an example for surface treatment? Surface heat treatment? One application. Surface treatment or surface heat treatment. It will be surface heat treatment. There is a separate division, engineering division, that is referred as surface engineering. Even I think in the National Aerospace Laboratories or ISRO, they have a separate division itself that is referred as surface engineering. So like the gear, you are familiar with the gear. So gear, you cannot make it very harder, because one of the requirement of the gear material should be, it should have good the wear resistance. To have good wear resistance, the material should be harder. If you try to make the whole gear harder, so then material, the gear become brittle. So whenever it is transfers power, because gear is a power transmitting element, so whenever it transfers power, the gear teeth may break. If gear is made of a very hard material, or by treatment, if you make it harder, so material may fail or it breaks, but it may serve the purpose. The one purpose of making the gear harder is to reduce wear, but at the same time its strength will be reduces, impact strength, especially in impact strength will be reduces, at any time it may break. So in such cases, we cannot go for the hardening the complete volume of the gear. Instead of that, only the gear teeth surface, the outer surface of the gear teeth, like a coating. The painting, you are for Almirah, etc., you are going for the painting. The painting purpose is avoid corrosion and some other aesthetic look, etc. In the similar way, to reduce the wear of the gear teeth or gear, so only surface of the gear should be hardened. There is a separate treatment. That treatment is referred as a surface heat treatment process. I hope you understood why, instead of going for complete hardening of the gear, whole gear, only surface of the gear of the depth of 1 mm or 2 mm or 3 mm, you are going for the hardening. But inside core part or inside part is still soft and ductile. The same case in the case of shafts also. So when you're going for the shaft should be able to withstand bending load, shaft should be able to withstand torsional loading. So in such cases, if the shaft is very brittle, then it may break at any time, because that's one extreme case. If the shaft material is very soft and ductile, then the wear resistance is very less, because shafts are mounted on the bearings, two bearing on the left hand side and right hand side. So yes, because of continuous rotation, so that the bearing part shaft may wear out. But if you try to make the shaft harder, or if you select brittle material for the shaft, so whenever it's subject to the bending load, at any time it may break. Like a glass. Glass will not take any bending load. It may take only the compression load. It will not take impact load. If you take one small hammer, if you hit the glass, it may break, except Teflon glasses. That again, Teflon glass undergo some amount of heat treatment process. So in such cases, instead of hardening the whole volume of the shaft, only the surface of the shaft is heat treated or surface treatment. Then such type of process is referred as a surface treatment process. The heat treatment is one of the process used for surface treatment. Anyhow, in details you are going to study the surface heat treatment process. Those are the general processing method. Then now I am showing only the photos to understand the processing. The powder metallurgy, especially high temperature application components, are produced by powder metallurgy application. That already was discussed in metal matrix composite, even ceramic matrix composite. The initially you have to prepare the powder, the fine powder. It may be plastic powder. If it is a plastic processing, it is a plastic powder. If it is ceramic metals processing, then it is a ceramic powder. If it is a metal matter, if it is a regular conventional metals, then it is a metal powder. Then you have to go for one more process, that is referred as a compacting. If a powder, if you keep as it is, it will not hold. Like your, I am giving the example of lado. That is a pretty initial. It is a powder. Then you have to initial compaction is also required. Compaction means you are made it to required size and shape. That's why it is called shape by compacting in a die. Then example are balls used in ballpoint pens. Even ballpoint pen, the tip. So that is produced by the powder metallurgy. The cams used in your internal combustion engine, cutting tools, the most especially high temperature application cutting tools, or high speed materials, high speed application, especially there are other than conventional machine like lathe, milling, drilling machine, there are high production machines. So that is normally referred as a CNC, computer numerical controlled machine. Everything is programmed. Even we have a computer numerical machine recently we have purchased. It costs around 20 lakhs rupees. So there, the speed of the cutting to the machine process is very high. In such cases, it should withstand high temperature. At the same time, it should have withstand the wear also. For that, we have to go for this powder metallurgy application. The bearings, especially self-lubricating bearing, that's one more concept. Continuously lubricate, because inside the component there is a small hole. Through that hole, lubrication oil is coming out. So that set type of bearings are referred as a self-lubricating bearing. Then we need to produce the powder. So to produce the powder, we know how we can produce the powder. Like your sand, especially in the case of artificial sand, you know, I think most of them are, you know, artificial sand. From the quarries, they have the stones, they break into pieces, they're finally made into powder. That is the way they are producing the convert the bigger size stone into the powder. That is a one more powder process, powder making process. That is a ceramic material. There are different methods are there to produce powders, but as per your syllabus is concerned, no need to worry about how powders are produced. So one is conventional crushing method. So there is some chemical method, some vapor physical method. There are many methods are available for production of the powder. Production of powder as per your syllabus not required. So once powder is produced, then it is referred to the blending. The blending is nothing but a mixing. So we have the powder, the powders are mixed, that process is referred to the blending, then powder compaction. The compaction is you have to press the powder in the like a pressing machine, then that process is referred to the powder compaction. So green, there is a difference between one is green compact. Imagine powders are mixed. Imagine we have ceramic material powder. It is mixed with metallic material. It is already mixed. Then it is pressed or compacted. Mixing is also referred to the blending process, and pressing is referred as a blend, the compaction process in the with respect to powder metallurgy. Then, once it is compacted, then it is referred to the green compact. So green compact means you are not heated. The later stage we have some slides, we can understand what is the meant by sintering process. So there is a, in the case of green compact, one particle is directly in contact with another particle. Just there is a mechanical contact. There is no physical bonding between atoms of one particle of the powder with another adjacent particle of the powder. You can think in that direction. Even though there is a physical, the direct mechanical contact because of the pressing, etc., like a sand particle, the sand particle is not joined together easily. That's why you are putting cement, etc. In the similar way, we have compact. So then we have initial compact, which is before heating, there is a just mechanical contact. So only few atomic bonding between the atoms of one particle with the adjacent atoms of the another particle to make the material stronger. So then we have to heat the material. That process is referred to as a heat treatment of the material. Heat treatment, it is also referred to as a one more term with respect to powder metallurgy. It is referred as sintering process. So don't think that these are the regular production process. It is not only required for your material science or only for the plastic or ceramic. These are the general production process used in almost all engineering process, not necessarily it is in only mechanical engineering. So then once we have the, imagine we have prepared the Lado, so there is a loose particle. There's a physical mechanical bonding, but it may break. So that is nothing but your green compact. So once it is heated, then physical bonding takes place between the atoms of one particle with another particle. So then it will become more and more stronger. So that is also referred to a diffusion welding process. So once you have to heat it in by using separate furnace, that particular furnace is referred to as a sintering furnace. During the sintering, for once it is heated, there is a lubricant also used. The initial bonding, because initially there is no the atomic level bonding, to have some contact with one particle with another particle, there are some amount of lubricant is also used. So during this heating process, because you're heating to around 200 degrees or 2000 degrees Celsius, the lubricant, the boiling point temperature, melting point temperature may be around maybe 100 or 200 degree or 300 degrees Celsius. It will evaporate because of heating to the very high temperature. So once it is sintering is over, then it is cooled down to the room temperature. These are the process. I have some more diagrams, don't worry about that. So plastic types already were discussed. We are going for processing of the plastics. It may be polyethylene, polypropylene, polyvinyl chloride, polystyrene, acrylics, polyamide, PET, polyethylene, terephthalate, and we are talking about polytetrafluoroethylene. It is also referred to as PTFE. Then one process, it is referred as the extrusion process. Can you give an example for the extrusion process in powder material, in composite material? You are talking about extrusion process. Can you give an example? One example for extruded product in composite material, especially in the polymer matrix composite, or even metal matrix composite also. The most of the steel rods used in construction, those are produced by extrusion. There are two processes you have to remember. One is extrusion and one more is drawing. Once you say drawing, it is not your engineering graphics or your CMD. The drawing, through drawing process, this small electrical wires are produced. Electrical wires are produced by drawing process. Electrical cables, even telephone cables, are related to telephone cables, not optical fiber, the regular conventional telephone cables, are produced by the drawing process, where material, hot metal, is pulled through that die. Once you say extrusion process, we have raw material. So in the case of metal, the raw material is a red hot rod. It is pulled through, pushed through the die. Then it is referred as the extrusion process. Imagine you have the die. You have to reduce 10 mm rod to 5 mm. You have to push it through the conical die. You are applying compressive load. So then it is referred as extrusion process. If you pulled through the die, then it is referred as a drawing process. You should be able to understand what is drawing process and what is extrusion process. So now, when you come to the polymer matrix composite, so most of the, these are the example, we can say in the, during extrusion process, we can get that it's almost like a pultrusion process. If the pultrusion is modified version of extrusion process, you can see here, I think I'll show it. I think you can see the bigger diagram. These are the extruded product, the polymer product, extruded polymer product. So if you see the extrusion, so I think you know what is screw mechanism. Here you have the hopper. So finally, what we have polymers. It will be extruded. Extrusion, along with the extrusion, you have to heat the material. You have to melt the material. Then we require three zones. One is feed zone, where polymer raw materials are fed into the extrusion device. It is an extrusion device. You heard about hopper. In most of the chemical processing, there is a hopper, especially in the mining process. Through the hopper, raw material is fed into this extrusion machine. So this particular screw rotates, this extruded, this hopper or raw materials, it try to push in the forward direction. On the rightmost, we have the die. You are familiar with the die. On the rightmost side, we have the die. So whenever this screw rotates, it will push the raw material in the forward direction. It is almost like there are two die casting process, where molten metal is fed to the die because of the gravity. You heard about die casting process? What is die casting, specialty of the die casting process? One of you can tell. So die casting or gravity casting, you can say it is a gravity casting process where the material is poured into the die, or molten metal goes to each and every intricate parts of the die or mold. Because of the gravity, we don't use any external pressure. So then it is referred to as a gravity casting. There is a one more injection molding, where the molten metal is forcefully injected into the die. So we know regular injection. If you go to hospital, they will inject injection. There is a pump. Through the pump, they will inject. Otherwise, the fluid is not enters into the body. That's why we require some extra pressure. So that's why there is an injection. In the similar way, in the case of injection molding, the molten metal is the force that are injected into the die. Here also molten, it is not molten metal, molten plastic is forced or injected, is forced into the die through extrusion process. There is a screw. Because of the screw rotates, we have a screw. There is a screw is inside the barrel, it is open, the cylindrical opening. So the thermocouples are mounted to know the temperature. So then during this, whenever the raw material, plastic material goes through the die or this extrusion chamber, so there is a melting zone where material is heated. So once material is in the melt, once material is melted, then it is pumped into the die. It is all the later part is almost like your injection molding process. We have the die, the molten metal is injected into the die, but here molten plastic is injected or pumped into the die. This diagram you have to practice. That is required for your metal matrix composite also, polymer, especially polymer matrix composite also, polymer processing also. So one is, if you come, this is the actual, you have seen, this is your schematic diagram, but this is a sophisticated machine. It may cost around minimum 40 to 60 lakhs rupees, this extruded extrusion machine. I think it may be computer operated. Everything is controlled through the computer or by programming. That is normal referred to as CNC machine, computer numerically controlled machine. The process involved is melting, the forming a preformed tube. The forming is taking place in the case of die. So those are the important steps. So now this is there is a one more process that is referred to as blow molding. The most of the bottles are produced by blow molding. So what is blowing? What is blowing? You heard about blower? Any difference between blower and the compressor? Any difference? Any difference between blower and compressor? You heard about blower? So you heard about volume flow rate. Even internal combustion engine also volume flow rate is important. Even gas turbine, everywhere volume flow rate is important. How much amount of volume is volume of the fluid enter into the combustion chamber? That is volume flow rate. That is normally meter cube per second. Normally you are saying meter cube per second. In the case of blower, the huge amount of the air is entered into the some space or chamber. The volume flow rate is very, very high, but the quantity of the pressure is very less. At low pressure, air is sent into the some chamber, let it be some chamber. That is the blower. But when you come to compressor, the volume flow rate is compared to blower, it is less, but pressure is very high because it is already compressed. That is the difference between blower and compressor. So now you are like a blowing the air. You know, your balloons, you are familiar. So you can put some air, you can make it bigger and bigger size. That is nothing but a blowing operation. So we have in the case of polymer process, you have to push the, first you have to push the raw material into the die. Again, it is a die, bottom portion is die. The first portion, first part is, you have to push the raw material into the die. It may be by extrusion blowing. As screw rotates, so it is forced, the raw material or polymer is melt inside the material, inside the extrusion material, extrusion machine. Then at the end, it is pumped further into the die. Once raw material enters into the die, the supply of raw material is cut off. Then there is one vertical member that is referred to, mainly used for the blowing process. Then bottom portion you have to clamp. So you have to close the mold. Once raw material is entered, you have to close the mold. Then bottom portion you have to clamp it so that air should not come out from the mold. then you have to blow it, the air with high pressure, then the raw material or molten metal will take the shape of the die. So finally you can say after cooling we'll get, after removing the mold, so we'll get bottle. It may be we'll get plastic bottle. You can see this is a one more schematic diagram. The raw material enters into the mold, then once sufficient amount of raw material enter into the mold, this bottom portion is closed, then air is blown. You can see from the bottom they have shown some arrows, the air is blown into the mold. So once air is blown into the mold, all raw materials stick onto the mold surface. So after cooling, so we can remove the mold, then we'll get some cylindrical component or hollow component. This is the actual blow molding machine. It is a pneumatic, I think, computer numerical controlled machine or CNC machine. So this is a sophisticated machine, may cost around a few crore rupees, especially for mass production of automotive parts. So now this is the one more diagram, you can understand better the how the blow molding works. The initially raw materials, the die, this is one half of the die, it is one or one more half of the die. It is cut section. So first initially the raw materials enters into the die. That raw material is also after the parison. So once raw material enters into the die, you are passing the high pressure air. We can see there is a one more arrangement. We are passing the high pressure air. So once high pressure air is passed, the all raw material is sticking onto the die surface. It's a molten raw material. So then you have to cool it. Once it is cooled, so you have to go for the demolding. Once you go for the demolding, then you will get molded part. The simple diagrams or schematic sketches are available in the textbook. And Panish textbook is also available. It is, we can refer that simple diagram that you have to practice. Schematic diagram you have to practice. That one is you have to practice the diagram. Another part is you have to understand how exactly whole process works. So now this is one more sketch. The initial raw material enters. You can say red. This red color is the raw material. Heated plastic is extruded into the hollow tube. Then mold. Once the complete sufficient quantity of raw material entered into the mold is closed. Parison is gripped in place. Parison is nothing but a raw material. Then compressed air is blown into parison. The parison is nothing but a raw material. So now we can say the parison fills the mold. A raw material fills the mold because you are passing the high pressure air. The once it is fills the mold, then so you have to, because there is a two mold, left mold and right mold, the top mold and bottom mold are cope and drag. It is like a cope and drag. Left mold and right mold, we can remove the mold, finally we get water bottle. This is the water bottle or plastic bottle. These are the example of blow molded component. You can see here including this water bottles. These are the different types of bottles used. All those plastic bottles are produced by blow molding process. There is a one more process that is referred to as calendaring process. It is mainly used for thermoplastic materials. The blow molding is mainly used for thermoset resins. For the thermoplastics, even calendaring process used for sheet metal work also. We can bend the sheet in a irregular or different manner depending upon our requirement. That process is also referred as a calendaring process. We have rollers. This is one more roller, one roller, this is one more roller. In between the roller, you are passing the thermoplastic material. It is almost like you are feeding the sugar cane into the sugar cane machine. The two rollers, the top roller and bottom roller, in between there is a small clearance space is available. Through this clearance space, you are feeding the sugar cane. Once it is fed, so that particular roller will pull the sugar cane. So then it crushes. In the similar way, calendar process also takes place, but there is the series of the disc or series of this roller. This is one roller. It is not a cylindrical shape. This not a spherical shape. It is a cylindrical shape. In the front view, it looks like a circle, but it is a cylindrical shape. Then it is formed to required size and shape. Then it is referred as a calendaring process. I hope you understood. It's almost like a sugarcane, works like a sugarcane machine. So you can see here, this is one more 3D photo, so you can understand better. This is 2D photo. For your examination point of view, again, simple sketch is available in the textbook. You can refer, you can practice, but you have to understand what is calendaring process. If you see only the simple sketch, you may not understand or you cannot imagine, but that's why I'm showing some of the photos. This is the actual 3D calendaring process. All our machines are three-dimensional machines. You can observe this is the thermoplastic sheet. It is heated slightly to higher temperature. Then it passes between the roller. Once it passes between the roller, depending upon how rollers are arranged, diameter of the roller will get required shape and size. It is the sheet is bent to required size and shape. So that process is referred as a calendaring process. I will not show this. So the calendar, through this calendaring process, flow types are produced, continuous flooring, the rainwares, shower curtains, table covers, thick table covers, pressure sensitive tapes, automotive and furniture upholstery, the wall covering, the luminous ceilings, signs and displays, all those things are produced by calendaring process. The blow molding already you have seen. There is a one more process that is referred as thermoforming process. It is again used for thermoplastic material. It is almost like a sheet metal work. So suppose you want to make automotive body, you are taking a sheet of particular alloy. You cannot bend the sheet as it is. Then you have to heat the material to certain temperature, not red dot temperature, certain temperature, so that it become more soft. Then you have to apply some amount of pressure. So then it is what is a thermoforming process. You are heating the metals, material, and forming to the required size and shape. Then it is what is a thermoforming process. I have some more diagram you can see here. This is the, imagine this is the heated plastic sheet. This is the upper die. This is a die. You can see this is a die. So imagine we require this type of shape. So then you have to move it down. So you have to apply the pressure from both sides, both end of the sheet. It's a sheet. It is not a steel rod or a thermoplastic rod. It is a sheet. Then it is bent to required size and shape, like a channel shape. You can bend it to required size and shape because there may be entrapped air inside the die. Between two halves of the die, to remove that, we are creating vacuum. That is referred to vacuum thermoforming. One is pressure thermoforming, and one more is vacuum thermoforming. So whatever may be, in thermoforming, you are heating the material. Then after heating the material, you are bending the material to the required size and shape. So that is referred as a thermoforming process. If the entrapped air is removed because there is in the die, otherwise there is a cushioning effect. We may not get required size and shape. For that, you are applying vacuum. So once you apply a vacuum, so now all air is removed so that we can get the required size and shape. Instead of connecting to the vacuum, if you connect it to the pressure pump, if you apply pressure, then it is referred to a pressure thermoforming process. So you can hear pressure thermoforming process. You are heating the plastic sheet. The first part is you are heating the plastic sheet. So then you are applying the pressure. You can see through it is connected to the compressor. So you are applying pressure so that all air inside the die is removed. To be on the safer side, they connected to the vacuum pressure also to avoid the further air entrapped inside the die. Main purpose is you have to remove the air inside the die so there is no cushioning effect. This material will bend as per our requirement. Finally, it will get required size and shape. That is after the pressure thermoforming. If you write one sketch, that is sufficient thermoforming. Not necessarily you have to describe both pressure thermoforming as well as vacuum thermoforming. In thermoforming, in general, you are heating the thermoplastic material. Then you are deforming the thermoplastic material to required size and shape. Then it is after the thermoforming process. We can see here. One more sketch. So it is the initially thermoplastic is heated. Then it is bent as per our requirement. So now we can see the thermo forming product. This, those are the previous are, that is only for the examination point of view, and test point of view is required to draw simple sketches. So, but now we can see how, what is the size and shape of the thermo forming machine, and finally component is coming out from the thermo forming machine. It is almost like a huge structure. It is not like a small machine. It is almost look like a our amphitheater area. That is a huge structure. So now this is one more thermoplastic component. Now it is first initially we have a sheet, plastic sheet. It is formed to required size and shape. That everything is depending upon the die. What type of die you are using? I think this meals plate you have seen, especially in the Swiggy and Zomato. They are supplying meals along with this type of plates. These are thermoformed. So this egg, this shell, what you call this container, again it is a thermoformed component. These are the practical examples of thermoformed component. I think we can see this how it is. I think video I have never seen. So we can see now how the thermoforming takes place here. Vacuum thermoforming. So these are the component produced by thermoforming process. And then there is a one more process, that is a compression molding. I'll show the some of the photos here. This sole of the shoe is produced by thermoforming in this compression molding. So now these are the schematic diagram. In the case of composite material, again you have studied compression molding. The charge is nothing but a raw material. In the case of composite material, charge is only the composite material charge consists of the plastic material or polymer plus reinforcement material. In the case of PMC, the charge is the polymer plus reinforcement material. In the case of plastic material, it is only the polymer, some catalyst or some other lubricants are added. That's a difference. Then it is compressed, compression molding. Then it is you have the charge. There is the upper die and lower die, or punch and the lower die. So then you have to keep the charge in the lower die. Then you have to move the punch so that it will be totally compressed. There is one ejector from the bottom. There is one more plunger arrangement. So once the material is produced, the this punch can be withdrawn. There is a machine, the punching machine. The machine itself, there is a mechanism to withdraw the punch. So then there is an ejector. Through the ejector, we can take out the component. Then it is referred as a compression mold. By applying compression pressure, compression load, we can get the required size and shape. But in the case of polymer processing, the charge is only the polymer material along with additives, some catalyst, etc. But in the case of polymer matter composite, the charge consists of polymer plus the reinforcement material. We can see here the rain boots are produced by compression molding. For that, we required the pattern also. So these are the patterns we studied in casting process. Casting process is very, very important. Don't think that is, don't neglect those subjects. Those are the basic manufacturing process. Most of the materials are produced by casting. Even plastics are produced by casting. Even ceramic materials are produced by casting. Metals are produced by casting. The rubbers are produced also produced by casting process. These are the pattern. If we require mold, so for the preparation of the mold, we require pattern. These are the patterns. So now in compression molding, you can see here. This is the charge. This is actual molding machine. This is the charge. This is the lower die. This is the punch, and sometimes it is heated also. Charge is heated, that's why it's connected to some heating element. So then, so a punch is die, the punch is coming, moved downward direction vertically. Then this complete charge is compressed. So once it is compressed, the punch is withdrawn. The after punch is withdrawn, they will get the required size and shape. Only thing is, you have to design the punch as well as die, depending upon our requirement. Most of the sheet metal work also done by similar type of process. Now this is the actual highly sophisticated compression molding. This is the lower die. This is the punch. Here, the charge is kept. then it is compressed. It may cost around 20 to 30 lakhs rupees if you see the sophistication of this particular machine is considered. So then there is a one more process that is referred to the injection molding. Even same injection, I think. Did you study the injection molding in your casting? You studied injection molding? Yes or no? In your metal casting and your welding technology, you're studying no manufacturing process in the third semester. I hope you studied. Even composite materials you studied. In the case of injection molding, the raw materials, it may be in the molten state. In the case of conventional metal casting, the molten metal is injected into the mold. Like I have given an example of injection. So for applying the molten metal with high pressure, there is a plunger arrangement or there is a extrusion injection molding process. You'll see some of this. You can see here, this is the raw material. The raw material is injected into the mold. Then it is referred to the injection molding process. This right part is a die. There are two half die. This is one die, left half of the die, and other one is right end of the die. So here raw material is not shown the complete diagram. You can see this is a complete machine. This part is a die. And this part is the feed hopper where the plastic is supplied. Then it is heated. Then it is pushed forward because of the movement of the screw. The once it is pushed forward, then it is injected into the mold. This right part is the mold. So here only right part of the mold is shown here. This is right part of the mold. How the component is, the raw material enters into the die or mold. Then once it is entered, then it is compressed. Then you can take out the component from the mold. So this is the principle of injection molding. So here hopper is there. You can see the hopper. I hope PPT is visible. Everything is fine. Yes or no? So now this is a hopper. The red. Red colored material is nothing but your plastic material. This is a illustrative drawing of the injection molding. Then hopper, because of the gravity, this material is put in the powder. It enters into this cavity. There's a screw arrangement. As this rotate, it moves forward. Then there is a heating element. The raw material is heated. It is in the molten form. Then there is a pump here to build some pressure. Through this pump, even because of the extrusion or this arrangement itself, as screw rotates, then it will push the molten plastic into the die. This portion is die portion. So then we can see inside the die are to cool it. Then you have to cool it. Once it is cool, the die is open, then material component can be taken out. Automatic arrangement is provided here on the left side. So automatic arrangement to take out the component or to eject the component. No need to worry about the complex diagrams. Simple diagrams, the line diagrams are available in the textbook. You can write those line diagrams for your test. But understanding, you require some of these diagrams. You can see here, this is the plunger type injection molding machine. This is the hopper we can see here. There is a screw arrangement. It pushes the plastic material and heat the plastic material further. And finally, it enters into the die. This is a plunger type. So this is a reciprocating screw. This is a hopper. There is a feed zone. Then there is a heater here from the outside. It is material is heated to the molten state or semi-molten state, then pushed into the die. On the rightmost, you can see this is the die. This is one more schematic diagram. This is the machine component. So you can see here how it is processed. So this is the plunger screw type. So raw material enters here. This is the feed. So enters here. It is as it screw rotates, it pushes the raw material forward. Here it is backward. Then there's a heating element. Red elements are nothing but a heating element. The thermoplastic material is heated further, or even it is melted. Then it is enters into the die, that is a injection molding. This is again one more sketch. This is finally components are taken out. This is the component. So this is can be taken out. Then once again die is closed. All everything is happening automatically. You can see these are the injection molded component. Even CDs are produced by injection molded component. The most of the Xerox machine outer side components are produced by injection molding. The fridge, refrigerator cabinet is how you can take out. You can see the refrigerator cabinet, each and every component, this small component. You can imagine how those are produced. Can you prepare CAD drawing? Can you prepare one mold in our foundry lab? Can you produce one small component? Then only you can understand what are the difficulties in manufacturing. It is designing is one part. The manufacturing to the intricate size and shape. Even if there is a clearance or there is clearance more than 1 mm or 2 mm, it not fits. Even Xerox machine, there is a sophisticated fitting. So it fits. The each and every component are fit without using nut and bolt system. Even this printing machine also made for this. So these are the different components produced by even comb. This also made up of this one. The lighter, again, these are the outer body of the lighter is again produced by injection molding. So all those components are produced by injection molding. So you can see here how injection molding works. There is one video. This is the injection molded component. So now you can see here, there is one more process that is referred to as resin transfer molding. What is this component? At least can you identify? What is this component? Can you identify this component? Can you identify? You're not able to identify?
So it looks like the back of a car.
Yes, it's a outer body. It is the outer body. Outer body of the car itself. So now, so you can see here, you know, how it is complex. Initially, you have to do the drawing in CAD drawing. Then imagine how the die and dyeing is to be prepared. The molding is also done. So a lot of each and even small component producing in the production shop, it required a lot of skills also required, not only the technical knowledge, especially preparation of mold, preparation of the die, it required skill, not only the technical knowledge. So now this is a resin transfer molding. So we have resin is in one chamber. It is in simple way, the resin is in the one chamber. It is transferred to the mold. The mold is already filled with reinforcement material. In the case of composite material, the reinforcement material as well as resin is joined together, and finally we'll get composite material. In the case of composite material, but in the case of conventional plastic process, we have the mold. So there is thermo. It is mainly used for thermo set plastics. We have the resin. Resin is a liquid form. It is in the one chamber. It goes to the mold. So mold is sometimes heated afterwards, or it may be cooled depending, because we require some curing. Most of the polymers cure at certainly slightly higher temperature. There are some polymers, especially thermoset polymer, they are cooled at room temperature, or the polymerized at room temperature. But there are some material which will be slightly heated to get the polymerization process. That is nothing but your curing process. So we have resin is in the one chamber. It is transferred to the mold by some arrangement. Then it is referred to the resin transfer molding. You can see here. This is the mold. The resin is in the other chamber. It is transferred to the mold. Then it is referred to the resin transfer molding. The same thing is used in composite material. So in the composite material, mold is already filled with the reinforcement material in the case of composite material. But in the case of just polymer processing, the mold is empty. Your thermoset resin is entered into the mold, and it get required size and shape depending on the the upper part of the mold and lower part of the mold, size and shape of the upper part and lower part of the mold. Then it is slightly heated, get polymerization process. We can see this is the one more component. So produced by the resin transfer molding. We can imagine how complex we are required. Two molds are required. You have to design the mold. Then, so designing the car component is, there is a one part. As a, then once component of the car is produced, the design, then design the jigs and fixture or design the mold. It is a one more complex complex task. So now this is the actual resin transfer molding. You can see how it is sophisticated. This is a resin transfer molding machine. So now these are the components produced by resin transfer molding. Even this is also this is produced by injection molding process, especially the mobile, the covers, so the old mobile covers. It is produced by the resin this injection molding. The resin transfer molding, how it is complex, we can see here. We are talking about the mold. This is one mold. This is the one more mold. One is upper mold and one more is lower mold. Then you have to close. Then you have to apply the resin. It is the most complex processes. In your regular textbook, it's there are only line diagram. So it looks very simple, but when you see the actual, if you go to some industry, they are involved in resin transfer molding. Then only you know the complexity of the machines. So then it is a ceramic molding, ceramic forming technique. The three one is slip casting, one more is tape casting, one more is powder processing. It is also referred to as a pressing machine. In general, already you discussed in the beginning, first class, long back we discussed. One is slip casting process, one more is tape casting process, one more is the pressing process. So hydro forming process, the hydro forming is almost, I have another 5 minutes, I'll finish. I think 2 to 3 minutes, I'll finish. It is almost like an extrusion process. We have the ceramic powder. We have the ceramic powder. It is heated to the red hot condition. Then it is pushed through the die. Red hot is a ceramic material. It's same thing is used for metal forming process also. But here, the material is the ceramic material. It is pushed through the die. Then it is referred to as extrusion process. If it is pulled through the die, then it is referred to as a drawing process. Imagine the initial diameter of the ceramic material is around 10 mm. Then it is, once it is pushed through the die, then diameter may be reduced to 5 mm from 10 mm. It is almost like how the steel reinforcement or steel rods are produced, which are normally used in construction industry. That is by extrusion process. We can see here. Hydroforming process, the hydraulic pressure is applied in the case of hydroforming process. Hydraulic pressure is applied. You can see here from the bottom, hydraulic pressure is applied. You can see here. Controlled fluid forming chamber. In the case of hydroforming, the hydraulic pressure is applied not through punch or die or mechanical arrangement. Hydraulic pressure is applied. You can see here. Hydraulic pressure is applied in all round the component. There are simple diagrams are available. First, you understand. So we have the powder. We have the powder of ceramic. It is pressed by hydraulic pressure, not by punching process. Now we can. This is a tape casting. The tapes are produced by tape casting process. This is, I think, Encyclopedia of Britannia. This diagram is available. You can, if you're really interested, you can check all the diagrams available. So we have a ceramic powder and solvent. Ceramic powder is mixed with the binding material. Then it is further mixed, then binder and additives are added, then it is further mixed. We have the slurry. We have the slurry. Slurry means we have ceramic. Normally, especially in the case of mining process, we understand what is slurry. The slurry consists of the ores along with some other, but ores along with the water. Then it is referred to as slurry. We have the slurry. It consists of the binder additives along with ceramic powder. It goes to the one more mixing here, normally after doctor blade. Then it after mixing it goes to drying area where it is heated and it is further sintered. The final we get the tape. Then it is ceramic tapes. So one is initial raw material is powder. it is mixed, it is a blending operation, mixing, then you have to add additives and binder, then homogenization is nothing but uniform mixing of that, then that particular slurry goes to slurry container, then it afterwards it is heated, it is dried, so all but during the process of the drying the binders and additives be evaporates, so then you get the tape, that is referred to as tape casting. There is the one more process that is referred to as slip casting. Again, slip casting, we have clay powder, the like a ceramic powder, along with some dispersing agent, the liquid. Those two are filled into the mold, or mold is already produced. So this is in casting, we study the mold. Similar type of mold is also to also used in the ceramic also. This was explained in the beginning also. So you are pouring the mold. The mold is nothing but a mold is the porous mold. So you are filling, this is not molten metal. You have to remember, you are not filling the mold with molten metal. Instead of filling the metal molten filled with molten metal, you are filling the mold with slurry. Slurry is a liquid, having a liquid medium along with ceramic powder. So once it enters, there is a porous mold. So all liquid will come out from the porous mold, plastic, there is an arrangement to drain the liquid particle, liquids. Then we have only solid ceramic material. Once you open the mold, we'll get this arrangement. Imagine you want to produce this component. This is made of ceramic material. That's nothing but a clay powder. You have to mix with some dispersing agent. We have slurry. The slurry is put into the mold. Then you have to dry it, or all liquid particles you have to take out. There is separate arrangement. Most of the time, the mold itself is a porous mold. The liquid is percolated through the mold. Then finally, some amount of heating is required. That is normally referred as a sintering process. Now, this is the actual slip casting. These are the slip casting mode. You can see this is the schematic diagram. This is the slip casting mode. You can see it is a slip casting. These are the mold. Slip casting, because it is not like a metal mold, the highly porous mold. So we can pour the slip. Slip is nothing but a ceramic powder along with some liquid. It is referred as a slip. Don't confuse what is slip. Slip is the raw material used in slip casting, consists of ceramic powder along with some dispenser or liquid. So now we can see here this portion already they have molded. The slurry is already poured into the mold. This is empty. Now molds with and without the slip. This backside, the already mold is filled with the slip. The front, the still yet to be filled. So now these are the slip casting die. Imagine this is inside. This is a closed mold. You heard about open molding and closed molding. This is a closed mold. Through this top, you are applying the slurry or slip. Then, because bottom there is a space is provided, through this bottom space this slurry or water will come out. That's why bottom there is a sufficient space is provided, because this mold is normally the porous, or bottom portion of the mold is highly porous. Only the ceramic particle will retain in the mold. The remaining will fluid particle will come out from the mold through the bottom, especially in this case. We can see here, this is the mold after slip casting. This is the component of the slip casting. The powder material already we have seen, initially powder production, compaction, sintering and finishing operation. So this is mixing of the powder, mixing. This is a powder lubricant along with alloying element. It is a metal, regular conventional metals. The mixing, then compaction, then it is heated to get the physical bonding or atomic level bonding between the grains of the powder. So then compaction, this is a mechanical compaction with the powder. This is compacted by upper die and lower punch. We can see compaction or pressing. Now this is a powder metallurgy press, we can see here. So this is the powder compact, it is pressed. The capacity of the pressing machine is very high. It may be few tons, 20 tons or 30 tons capacity. The isostatic pressing, so where powder is pressed uniformly throughout the, around the mold. Imagine this is the mold. So powder is pressed uniformly. Then for that you are using hydraulic pressure, cold isostatic pressing, at room temperature pressing. It may be hot isostatic pressing. we have the component, portal metallurgy component or green compact. This is heated as well as pressed by hydraulic pressure or uniform pressure. Then it is about the isostatic pressing. This is the hot isostatic process. We can see here, this is the photo component. So inside there is a pressing or arrangement. So you can see some electrical element, heating element. It is the raw material is heated. Along with that, it is pressed. So now there is a sintering process we have already studied. So once in the green compact, and green compact is nothing but I am given example of Lado. You are familiar with the Lado. The one particle of the Lado is kind of indirectly in contact with the another particle of the Lado. It is a just mechanical contact like that. When you come to ceramic processing, the one particle is directly in contact with another particle. There is only mechanical contact. There is no physical or atomic level bonding. To get atomic level bonding, you have to go for heating the compact. So we have a heat. So we have earlier there are three particles. Now it is all three particles are bonded together. The final become, it will become single entity. So now this is your sintered component, because it will become single entity because of heating. So once when the material is heated, atomic atoms will get more and more energy. Then it will try to have bonding with adjacent atoms or particle atoms of the adjacent particle. That is happening the inside the material during the sintering process. That will finish your the processing of plastics and ceramics. So next class you are going for the one more module, that is the fourth module you are going. Before going for the fourth module, you have to study some fundamentals or phase diagram, then and iron carbon diagram. Then you can go for the heat treatment process. First we are studying fundamentals for the heat treatment process. That required is one is phase diagram and one more is iron carbon diagram. After studying those two, we can go for heat treatment process. Okay, I'll stop the session now. So if you have any doubts, you can clarify now. If there is no doubt, after you already entered your USN number and name, you can leave the session. I'm going for stopping the recording process. Those are not entered your USN number. Please enter.